I feel it. I feel it. I'm there. I'm live. Wow, games. That's what it is. And speaking of games, we have Gabriel Yanagihara. He's the game guy at Iolani School, Sullivan Center. Welcome to our show.
Ah, thanks for having me on ThinkTech.
Yeah, well, we want to do it multiple times and check in with you every now and then, see what you're doing.
Oh, yeah.
And what the kids are doing, actually.
Oh, that's the best part. I can just show off what they've been up to.
So give us an update on life in gaming and 3D reality.
Yeah,
and
so we've been expanding our computer sciences program over at Iolani School, and we've recently made some purchases into virtual reality. And having the students try it out, just explore with it, try it out in a bunch of our different classes, yeah. And just let the teachers kind of explore and play with it and see what they come up with.
But you don't just play with it, you program it?
Yeah, so for the first phase, right, we just want the kids to kind of get a idea of virtual reality, right? Right now we're working with the Oculus Rift, you know, get them in there, see what the world feels like when they can't, you know, it's not the physical table in front of them, they're in this virtual world, right? So letting them get their, you know, we call them VR legs, so mm-hmm. you don't get motion sickness, you kind of get used to it, right?
Oh, yeah, right.
So let them play around with it, and then we're going to be launching, or we're currently launching that class right now, where the students are going to be programming their own apps for virtual reality.
Which that's fabulous.
Oh, I'm so excited.
Yeah, wow. So, you know, I mean, I tried one. We had somebody in the studio, I don't think it was you, it might have been, mm-hmm. Maybe a year ago, and the Oculus, you remember things. Oh, here's a picture.
Yeah.
There it is. There it is. And she's touching things, and they stay out there in space in certain coordinates, like forever. Yeah, this is really interesting. You build a whole universe, don't you?
You can. I think when I was originally, we're starting with, before VR, right? One of our most popular workshops for the students was Minecraft, right? Letting them build with essentially virtual Legos, right? And all the curriculum and all the lessons that you could run if you had an unlimited amount of Legos in your classroom, right? You can come up with some pretty cool classes that way. So what we were taking from there is now you're in a world where you can build and modify the entire world around you. Minecraft just launched their virtual reality version of the Minecraft for Windows 10, and with that, you know, we're having students, so instead of just, you know, being on their iPads kind of hunched over there, they're actually up and building and moving and trying out all their little creations in there.
Fabulous. You know, just a footnote, I need your help on something about Microsoft 10 after the show.
I'd like definitely
to take you a look and show you what I'm talking about. Anyway, so think about programming. So how do you program Oculus? How do you do that on a regular PC?
So right now what we're working on is we have a Mac lab, but we're working with a free game engine called Unity. They recently released their educational licenses, right? So any school can apply to get free licenses as well. Indie developers, right? If you're on your own, if you're just a startup on your own, it's also free. Mm. There's free personal editions. And it's basically an environment that lets you start arranging and setting up your game. So in the easiest terms, it's a program that you run and you can build games in it, and then it's very easy to publish those games on pretty much any of the platforms, right? Windows, OS X, iPad, Android. So you can pretty much launch it out.
There's one program. This one platform.
Program.
It's pretty
free,
good.
Right?
And so, I mean, what is it? I know we don't have it with us. We're not going to be able to show it on the screen, but conceptually, how does it work?
Conceptually, like,
that?
I mean, if you worked with any other, like, a 3D environment, I've come from a 3D modeling and animation background, so it's a 3D space, or 2D if you want, and then you can just drag and drop game objects in there, like you can drag your little Mario character, you can drag your other character in there, and then you assign a programming script to each of those characters and have them start interacting with each other in the game.
This is like animation, but on steroids or something.
Yeah, and it's getting even bigger too, because a lot of the indie games that you'll see as either Steam Greenlight projects, which is kind of like a, not Kickstarter per se, but kind of a crowdsourced, you know, select which games you want to see come out option. So there's that as one option for they can do, they can play with it. And then the other one is kind of letting them, so taking Unity, right, and then publishing their games as they want to go with it.
So, these kids come in, do they have game experience? Do they, you know, I mean, one of my partners, his kid used to stay up till 2-3 o'clock in the morning. He was like in the seventh grade, and his dad didn't know what to do because it was consuming him. They come in to you with that kind of experience?
It's pretty cool. Like, I mean, imagine coming into like a math class, and then the students are the experts at math, and you're kind of just like, okay, so now that you guys already know everything, right? They know, like, they say they're huge math fans, right? They know, they played all the math math games. They've done every math problem they can get their hands on. Yeah. But now you're going to show them, all right, here's academically what you can do with that skill set, right? Yeah. So we get a lot of kids coming in. They've played lots of video games. They're very familiar. They're digital natives, right? They're very familiar with that entire space.
Yeah.
But they haven't quite gone through the program.
Oh, here's
track.
Some virtual reality.
Yeah. That's the Rock Band. That's going to be really cool. I haven't gotten one myself, but we're going.
So how does that work? He's wearing the goggles. He's also playing.
I think for the VR, I think the new Rock Band they're releasing is you put the goggles on and imagine like you're on the front stage in front of an entire crowd of people and you can rock out, right? Because with the last Rock Band, like I love that game, but it'd be just my friends and I kind of just sitting in our, you know, in our room, right? You see like, you know, all our laundry on the side and all our books and computer stuff everywhere. But you put then the goggles on and suddenly you're right there next to, you know, whichever celebrity will sign with that brand, right?
And you turn to him and see him?
Yeah.
You turn your face forward and you see 10,000 people? Whatever.
Yeah. I think it'd be really cool if they could, I mean, you know, if they get the licensing and everything for reviving old bands, right? So you could play next to the Beatles or next to whichever one, whoever they sign up for,
fabulous.
Right? That'd be super cool. I mean, my students won't really get that, right? They might be like, all right, which is the current
Beatles
ones, right? We want to see, you know, Chainsmokers, or we want to play with Daft Punk or something like that.
The old guys like me, I don't care if your students understand.
You want to try it out, yeah. Rocking with the Beatles. That would be cool. That'd be see if that's, that brand, that IP has a revitalization with VR.
Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, so many questions flow into my mind about this. I mean, this is moving so fast.
It's amazing.
When I saw you last, it wasn't like this. It's changed, and it's changing too. Mm-hmm. And you got to stay up with it. Now, to stay up with it and to be relevant for them in their expectation that you're going to take them right to the edge of the envelope, yeah? How do you do that? You just go with the flow? Or do you read up and study up?
What? A lot of it is there's lots of really great communities online. There's actually a Facebook group for educators run by one of my colleagues, Mike Furcano, and it's virtual reality in education. So basically it's a crowdsource information feed, but basically all the teachers in the world who are kind of dabbling with virtual reality, they share the content with each other, right? So he set that up, he pioneered it out here from Hawaii, right? And now all the other teachers are hopping on board and like, hey, I tried Google Expeditions, right? I tried this Google Street View, I tried CoSpaces, I tried ThingLink, there's all these different startups happening. There's so much information, there's no way one person could run through it all, right? But as an education community, everyone can kind of, you know, share their little bit.
Yeah, you got to do that. So what are your favorite sources? What are your connection points?
Definitely that Facebook group run by Mike Furcano. The other one, just kind of keeping up to speed. There's a bunch of YouTube channels that I just like to watch from here and there. And of course, the students, right? The students are definitely watching a lot of YouTube videos
talking about
Let's Plays, which is where the YouTube host will have like his variety talk show, but he'll try on a bunch of different games that people send him, and then they'll see the good ones, and they'll come to me like, oh, Mr. Y, did you hear about this game? Did you hear about this game? And then I'll be like, yeah, I totally heard about that game. Write it down and go research it later, right? And pretend like I'm kind of getting an idea for how it's going. Yeah. But it's even expanding to the mobile market too, right? You can get your small phone, right? And even any phone, any Android or Windows phone, or even Apple phone, right? The iPhone can run a virtual reality headset, right? Google is launching their Dream VR, which is their mobile headset.
Oh, is that right?
We work with Google a lot, so we have the Google Cardboard, which is like a foldable piece of cardboard that when you fold it up and put it together, it becomes a headset, right?
$1.95, yeah.
For like $1.95. If you remember back to those old days where it's the red, what is that, ViewMaster or something, where you just click the thing and it cycles through the disc?
Right.
Right? It's like they rebuilt one of those digitally now. So you can like click the button and instead of being inside, just looking at one view, you can look all the way around and you'll see whatever you're doing up there. And then that same idea, right? Imagine you could get a classroom set of those, right? Give them to all your students, and you can take them on a field trip in the classroom anywhere in the world. And we've been doing a bunch of projects with that. Mike Furcano, who's also a colleague of mine, has been doing a lot of Google Cardboard expeditions with the students. I think the last big one that we did was doing the memorial for the Pearl Harbor attacks.
Uh-huh.
uh-huh. we had the students take virtual tours of the Arizona, of the Missouri, in the classroom so they could run along.
So what is it about these virtual tour, virtual reality? You know, not, I hate to tell you this, Gabriel, but not everybody out there has actually tried it yet.
Yeah, yeah, so that's definitely a new one.
What is the experience that makes it so magical?
So, as opposed to like kind of looking at it on a TV monitor, right? So when you're looking at the monitor, it's kind of still looking at it through a picture frame. But once you put the goggles on, and with the higher quality ones, like with the Oculus Rift or the Vive, where you have the audio as well, the 360 audio, when you put it on, everywhere you turn, you get the sensory input of whatever you're looking at in that position, right? So you can see here the people are kind of looking around, yeah. and whatever each of them are seeing a whole different world. So they could be, one could be in China, one could be in Shanghai, one could be, you know, or in Shanghai, China, the other one could be here in, you know, in the middle of Diamond Head checking
yeah.
it out.
Yeah.
And it's been launching like some really cool student projects as well where they wanna share their spaces, right?
So when they sit at the table like this, they're talking to each other,
yeah.
they're comparing about their own reactions to these various places. Now, where's the data coming from? Is it coming from the device itself or from a computer or wireless? Where is it coming from?
Yeah, so, I mean, depending on which quality of device you're
using,
right?
Take the best one, the Oculus Rift.
So for the Oculus Rift, it's using the computer to feed a separately rendered image into each eye. So what that doing is
separate
it's creating...
Separate images for each eye.
Separate okay. image for each eye, because it's like the screen inside the device is split, yeah. and then it's feeding a different one into each eye. So what yeah. that allows us to see is the 3D parallaxing that happens. So like if you know, when you move your finger across your eye, your two eyes are seeing slightly different images. But now we can simulate that on the computer. So as opposed to just, you know, looking through a screen and seeing what's right there, where you can move your head around, you can walk around the room, and then you'll see all the objects from different angles.
Yeah.
And it looks 3D to you.
And somehow the machine is able to give you that 3D
yes.
experience. You're among the objects. You're in the room.
You're in the world, which is the big sell for it right now.
But this is all a matter of data. Somebody has built it, probably with gaming
yep.
technology,
yep.
and all this drag and drop animation kind of graphical interface is really mm-hmm. fabulous. But I have a question for you.
Yes.
My question is, well, preface to the question. We just got mm-hmm. this thing called Live View. Mm-hmm. Live View is a little backpack you wear, and you connect it to your video camera, mm-hmm. and it has what they call bonding technology.
Uh-huh.
And the bonding technology bonds up half a dozen cell phone accounts, modems, okay, mm-hmm. and now it has very fast broadband.
Okay.
So my camera is going to report back to my studio here,
mm-hmm.
okay, with the best broadband that you can get anywhere
yeah.
there are any cell phone towers, okay? And the result is we can go live. Okay.
From anywhere, yeah.
From anywhere. Anywhere in the world, right?
Yeah, that's awesome.
I mean, and in fact, it's curious that I saw, the first time I saw this was at the commemoration of the Pearl Harbor attack
yeah.
at Pearl Harbor. It was a guy who had one of these things, and he was sending it back live to New York,
mm-hmm.
standing right next to me with a little thing. So you talked about these people. Who can be anywhere in the world.
Yes.
And see all these things on the virtual reality and compare notes and have this kind of joint experience at the table with all this really fabulous input coming in.
Yeah.
Why can't that input be coming in from all over the world? You say, oh, they can be here, they can be there, they can be anywhere. Why can't it be live with my little backpack?
So there's going to be a camera that I'm going to tell you about that you might be a little excited about. It's called the Theta S. So it's a small, it looks like the old Flip HD. It's a small rectangle like this, and it launched, like, I think they're on their second iteration now. The video quality isn't amazing yet, right? They're still working out the kinks, and I think they're doing, like, a release stages to get better and better at it. But it also lets you live stream in 360. So what that software does and what the current workflow, I'm not super familiar with it, but the current workflow that I know of is that you can live stream from that to a Twitch account or to a live stream account. And then on the opposite side, on the receiving side, again, if we have good enough internet, you can have the goggles set up, right? You can have the virtual reality headset, and then you can see whatever that camera is live streaming immediately.
There it is.
So there's some really cool tech going on with that.
A regular one-dimensional camera is not going to do it for the Oculus.
Yeah, yeah,
okay?
yeah.
but one of these cameras would. Mm-hmm. And if you put my live view backpack, we call it baby in the yeah. middle, then you can go to anywhere in the world and deliver Oculus Rift quality of visual experience. Whoa.
Yeah, the thing that's really, the one thing that's holding that back right now, though, is the resolution on the live streams. A lot of them are kind of standard 1920 by 1080 resolution, which is standard, monitor resolution. But when you take a 360 photo, what it's doing is wrapping all the data around you and then compressing it into a flat 1920 by 1080. It's like unwrapping it onto a flat screen. So when you re-unwrap it, you lose a lot of resolution. So when you see the really high quality 360 videos and stuff on YouTube and stuff, a lot of time they're playing at 4K. So we don't, like, our mobile networks and everything aren't quite ready for 4K streaming just yet.
Yeah.
But I can definitely see that. I mean, VR has been exploding so much in the last couple of years. I can very easily see that in the pipeline soon.
But I can tell you that baby can do 4K.
Yeah.
I'm telling you that
4K
now.
Streaming? That
yeah,
would be
amazing.
We'll
take a short break so we can integrate all this because the sides of my head are hurting. We'll be right back with Gabe and Yanagihara.
I'm Ethan Allen, host of Likeable Science here on ThinkTech Hawaii. Every Friday afternoon at 2 p.m., you'll have a chance to come and listen and learn from scientists around the world. Scientists who talk about their work in meaningful, easy to understand ways. And you'll come to appreciate science as a wonderful way of thinking, way of knowing about the world. You'll learn interesting facts, interesting ideas. You'll be stimulated to think more. Please come join us every Friday afternoon at 2 p.m. here on ThinkTech Hawaii for Likeable Science with me, your host, Ethan Allen.
Hello, my name is Crystal. Let me tell you, my talk show, I'm all about health. It's healthy to talk about sex. It's healthy to talk about things that people don't talk about. It's healthy to discuss things that you think are unhealthy because you need to talk about it. So I welcome you to watch Quok Talk and engage in some provocative discussions on things that do relate to healthy issues and have a well-balanced attitude in life. Join me.
I want to be there. He's already there.
I've already downloaded that entire thing.
It's Gabriel Yanagihara of Iolani School. So you start out with gaming, and you learn how to game, and then you go to, it's a natural progression to visual reality, 3D, and Oculus Rift, and, you know, and nobody knows where that's going to go.
Yeah, it's an exciting field to be in.
But you're going to follow it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You could not follow it.
At this point, I'm kind of like, I'm along for the ride.
Yeah.
It's ups and downs and whatever, yeah, you know, whatever happens, we're going to be really excited to see what.
So tell me about the Ignite program that you're doing or you're involved
Yeah, so we've been doing a lot with the robotics programs at Iolani with the app class, which is going to be making VR projects. And we wanted to have a venue for our students and faculty who we are allowing to kind of explore with all this new cutting edge tech. See what they did, what they found as best practices, and just share it out for everyone to see. So a lot of our teachers and a lot of our students are going to be doing presentations at the Ignite Innovation Conference, which is going to be at the Sullivan Center at Iolani School.
The world begins and ends at the Sullivan Center.
Yeah. It's,
Everybody's the center of the universe.
And I get to live on the third floor. It's amazing.
Wow.
But no, I set up camp there, and then we're going to have the conference. I think the conference is going to be February 18th.
I want to come.
We'll love to have you.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So I'm talking about the kids for a minute.
Yeah.
Okay? Kids respond to this. I mean, they come with a certain amount of experience at home and all that, and then they light up when they get into a classroom setting where you can show them things they didn't know, where you can understand things they tell you, mm-hmm. which is important, and where you can structure their perception of these things so that now it becomes more real. It's no longer just a hobby.
Yeah.
It has real life impact.
Life and educational economic impact directly on them. If they create the next Flappy Bird game, right, they can go to any college they want out of pocket, right?
It's true, but not only games though, because this gaming technology often leads to real technology.
Yes.
I shouldn't say that, but technology that is used in the marketplace
for
other things. Yeah.
Yeah, simulations. There's a lot of talk now in the medical field, like how else can you use virtual reality? How else can you use gaming for the betterment of patient care, old folks' homes, right? How can you, improve the lives of the people who maybe may not be as mobile, right? One of the projects that our group of students are doing now is they're doing 3D scans of the hikes here in Hawaii. And they hope you know, hopefully once they can create their program in Unity with that and create like virtual tours of Hawaii.
No more necessary for hike.
There's so many side projects you can do with that. You could throw that on the Google Cardboard, right? Yeah. Give that to, you know, grandma, grandpa, right? Yeah. People who, or give it to the hospital and let people, you know, explore the outside world
sure,
of Hawaii
yeah,
when they don't
great.
Need to, right?
Without standing yeah. up, yeah. So these kids come to you. Is it every kid comes to you or just the kids
it's
who want?
It's elective class, so the kids who want to. So I think the easiest example would be letting students, so the reason we have the intro video game design class, which is 7th and 8th grade, is to let students kind of get under the hood of the games that they're already excited about, right? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of like back in the day when you'd have auto shop, right? Everyone's super into cars, we love cars. All right, let's make it academic. Let's people, you know, instead of you just buying a car and then yeah. paying, you know, a couple $100 every time it breaks down, yeah. let's teach you what the inside of the car is like yeah. so you can build your own version of it, right? Yeah. And especially now with gaming, the gaming tools are all, they're free, yeah. right? Yeah. Anyone can pick up and make a game. We're showing them, don't just be consumers of digital technology. Don't be just a consumer of the iPad where you just put the money in and, you use it.
Engage with
it. Get underneath it, right?
Understand
how it works. It's such a big part of your life.
The whole thing, make it
make the
yourself.
Next Apple and remember me when it's time to retire.
Yeah. They send you a check. Yeah,
yeah right.
But I wanted to ask you about that, Gabe. So you take these kids who elected because they really like this kind of information technology. That's a broad term to define. And you excite them and you show them things they didn't know before and you, you bring them into a conversation about it. You bring them into a community thought process mm-hmm. about it. Now it sort of changes their lives and they begin to see the possibilities as you do. They catch, it's viral.
Yeah.
They catch whatever you have, they catch it.
Yeah.
Okay, and they graduate.
Yes.
And then they go to the mainland.
Well, that's what's great is it's just the start, right? They've got a head start over all their peers to kind of, one thing that I think Iolani and Dr. Cottrell has been really successful in with Iolani is pushing it not just, you don't just graduate with, well, I've memorized all the chemical formulas, I've studied for the test, I can get through that, but now it's, well, I did good on my academics, but guess what? I also have 2 games published. I also built my own drone. I've built a drone that flew over to the Alawai, picked up a water sample, did bacteria testing on it.
This
and
true?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So our robotics program has been phenomenal. Martin MD is leading our robotics program.
Yeah.
And the kind of robotics projects that they have 7th, 8th grade kids starting on has been, it's blown my mind. I don't know how he's been doing it.
Well, it's blowing my mind.
Yeah.
I wasn't even there. Okay, so they go to the mainland, okay,
yeah.
and they're not only are they talented, smart, motivated, but they also have experience in the class for you, mm-hmm. with you, and the robotics too, and all the stuff. They are poised for success yeah. in the IT world. And Lord knows where that'll take them, mm-hmm. but it doesn't take them back to Hawaii, does it? There are no jobs here for this.
Well, what's really
except
interesting.
Your job. Well, I want your job.
I was very lucky with getting set up where I am. But one thing that's really interesting with the indie game industry and with mobile markets, right? Yeah. You can be set up anywhere.
On the beach.
And you can literally, I have 2 or 3 friends here. They hang out on the beach. They have their laptop. They go to Starbucks. They work on their app. And their app brings in a couple grand a month, and they just hang out in Hawaii.
Not a bad deal.
Not a bad deal. And then what's good is we're building up a lot of that local community here, right? There's another group, Dev League Hawaii, who are creating a lot of developers here. And there's a growing community of game designers here in Hawaii. And there's also a lot of opportunities, pretty much if you decide that you want to live in Hawaii and you want to be your own boss, there's not a lot of things holding you back.
Well, the thing is, if you were on a beach alone in another time, say 20 years ago, trying to do something like this, you would be alone. You wouldn't be connected. You wouldn't be able to sell your stuff, find anybody who'd pay you for it or, help you with it.
Yeah.
Do collaborations and partnerships and the like to make yourself, to make some money. But now, on the beach, it's not necessarily the case. You can find people who will help you and mentor you
yeah.
and connect you
yeah.
and pay money to you, right? Am I right?
Yes. So it's a growing community here, right? And I think that would be one of the really cool initiatives because digital IP, so digital intellectual property, digital projects like that, where you can work with people anywhere in the world, you don't need an office space. You don't need real estate, right? You don't need a whole lot of energy, right? So a lot of things that limit business here in Hawaii, you know, your IP, you have an idea that has an intellectual property based in Hawaii, right? You don't have to worry about, you know, making the kind of higher rent and stuff that you have to deal with
here. Do they take older gentlemen in your class? Can I sign up?
We do have open nights. Where I have open to other educators, and we just share all the curriculum and all the stuff that we've been working on with anyone who's interested in growing the community.
So where is it going, Gabriel? I mean, one of the things you mentioned that was touching to me before we started was the notion that one day something would happen, and all of a sudden you would realize that you're not their big brother anymore. You're their uncle or their father, your grandfather, and you would not occupy the same role anymore.
Tell me about that. I've been riding the cool older brother teacher for a long time, and I think I still got a couple years left before I start, you know, I get like two gray hairs for now until I start getting a bit older. But I think for the now, like, you know, being, I don't think I'll ever stop being engaged with the tech community. Like, it's my, you know, final frontier. It's, you know, we've mapped the world, we've been everywhere. Technology is the last bastion of real exploration that I see that is accessible to the average person.
Yeah. So where is Hawaii going on this? Granted, there are some people who understand they can go to the beach, make a buck, you know, participate in a kind of virtual community. Where is the industry going to go? Do we have it? Will we have it? Can we get together on this and make something happen?
I think the biggest thing that we can do is form our closely knit and keep growing our closely knit community of game developers. We have the Global Game Jam, which is an annual event. We have a couple other meetups where all the, you know, different programmers, 3D artists, game designers, virtual reality people all get together and talk story about our industry here. It'll be really cool to see more students come and get involved, more educators come involved, reach out to some more of the business side of things here, and just see what services can we offer here in Hawaii that are not, you know, real estate and energy based, that we can just expand and can scale anywhere, because we can have the idea here and just pay for Amazon to have the servers, you know, in the mainland in some warehouse somewhere and run the entire situation that way. So they're really, with the internet, with all that stuff, there's really not a set location that we need to be.
And you can show them how.
Oh, I hope so.
You can give them, you know, the leverage, the understanding, the way to find a career in this at any level they want.
Yes, I'm hoping so.
Yeah. We gotta close the show now, Gabriel. It's been really wonderful.
At least as good as last time,
maybe even better. I'm so excited. And one of the reasons we're closing the show is because I'm having this problem with my PC, and I need to hold on to him for a few minutes so he can help me understand what's going on.
Okay. Oh, I'll be glad to help you.
Gabriel Yanagihara, Iolani School. Wow. I'm gonna go back to school again.